that Trade Center manager. TCMA has had the distinct pleasure of managing the Ronald Reagan Building and International Trade Center for the past 20 years on behalf of the United States General Services Administration. What makes this building so unique is that it came with a congressional mandate to promote trade and cross-cultural awareness. So today's program, that you're at, Culinary Medicine Made Easy, Mediterranean Lifestyle Tips for Optimum Health, fits in so well with our mission for the building and the kinds of programs that we try to bring to you and to the people of the greater Washington, D.C. area. Not only do we promote trade through our offices in the World Trade Center Dublin, the World Trade Center Boston, and here in D.C., we facilitate trade by connecting buyers and sellers and investment opportunities across borders. Our trade office here in the building is called the World Trade Center of Washington, D.C. We operate trade missions on behalf of the U.S. government, and we work through our network of fellow World Trade Centers in about 300 locations, in about 100 countries, to open doors and make unique connections for our clients. Throughout May, we've had the pleasure of celebrating World Trade Month by hosting a very dynamic slate of programs. I believe we had about 24 programs throughout the month, this being our final World Trade Month in May. And the programming has been on things such as culinary diplomacy, culture, and trade promotion. We're a unique entity here in that we're the operators of this conference center, and our executive chef is one of the panelists here today. So we actually have a unique role in being heavily invested and involved in the culinary aspects of planning and crafting creative dishes for just about every kind of social function that you can imagine. And we had about 2,000 of them over the last year here in the building. Just a couple of weeks ago, we hosted the Embassy Chef Challenge, and we had about over 28 embassy chefs in here competing in front of some celebrity judges while they prepared authentic dishes from their countries, and they celebrated their culture through dancing and entertainment. Another way that we facilitate trade here at the Trade Center is digitally. We have a proprietary web platform called Webport Global. Any of you that are in business for yourself, you may be interested in checking out webportglobal.com as a way to source materials and find buyers and possibly investors abroad. So finally, in honor of World Trade Month and Mediterranean Diet Month, we have teamed up with Dr. Sam Pappas, a Mediterranean lifestyle advocate, and award-winning chef and author Amy Riolo, to explore how ancient daily living traditions from the Mediterranean region can provide solutions to chronic modern health epidemics while creating new avenues for diplomacy and trade. Amy Riolo is a true guardian of the techniques and inherent goodness of the Mediterranean lifestyle. As a chef, culinary expert, and educator, Amy is known for sharing history, culture, and nutrition through global cuisine. She's a culinary thought leader who enjoys changing the way that we think about food and the people who create it for us. Dr. Sam Pappas is a board-certified physician in internal medicine. He completed medical school at Pennsylvania State College of Medicine and his training at Case Western Reserve University, University Hospital in Cleveland, Ohio. This morning, both Chef Amy and Dr. Pappas will discuss the benefits, foods, and trade origins of the Mediterranean diet, as well as the health perspectives of this incredible new lifestyle. I shouldn't say new. This is a long-tested lifestyle. We also will hear from an expert panel of speakers, which includes our very own executive chef, Xavier DeHay, as the panelists share their expertise on the benefits of the Mediterranean lifestyle and how we can work together to promote it globally. We hope that you enjoyed today's program, and like you, I'm very eager to hear from our speakers and panelists, and now I'd like to invite Chef Amy to the stage. Thank you all.
Thank you all so much for coming today. Thank you very much, Andrew, for those amazing comments. for hosting us here today. It's such an honor to be here and to spend the last day of World Trade Month and Mediterranean Diet Month with all of you. We had the idea for this topic because, as you know, the Mediterranean diet and lifestyle is actually dwindling even within the Mediterranean. So as Americans are becoming more and more aware of it and attempting to embrace it, there are so many rich traditions that we can take advantage of, but we also want to remember that they still need to be preserved in the Mediterranean region as well. So that's kind of a little bit of a background behind the topic of today's event. And what we're going to do today is to define the Mediterranean lifestyle and its impact on trade and diplomacy. We'll discover how the Mediterranean lifestyle can lead to optimal health. We're going to talk about some cultural facts and historical facts, and we'll wrap it up with a little bit of questions. We also are going to have a panel discussion, so our presentation will be about an hour. First I'll speak, then Dr. Pappas will speak, then we'll have a panel discussion, then we'll do some Q&A, and we've got some bags for everybody with a few goodies to take home. So feel free to listen and just write down your questions, and then at the end we'll be able to take all of them. Here's a map of the Mediterranean region. So when I speak about the Mediterranean lifestyle, I like to make sure that all of the countries within the Mediterranean region are covered. Usually people focus on Italy, Greece, and Spain, which are wonderful places to focus on, but that's not to say that the south of France and Morocco and Egypt and Israel don't have a lot of very important things, tips, strategies, and lifestyle trends to offer on the topic. So I like to talk about everyone from the west all the way to the eastern part of the Mediterranean. And I wanted to start with some statistics because I think it's important as we look at the lifestyle. It always seems like kind of a nice, dreamy thing. It doesn't really have anything to do with business. It's just, an idyllic lifestyle. But it really can affect business, and there is a lot of trade going on in the Mediterranean because of this lifestyle. So the overall value of the Mediterranean exports to the rest of the world is about $1.2 trillion. So the United States, $120 billion, are the Mediterranean's primary export destinations. The U.S. also has the third most prevalence of exporting to the Mediterranean. So that's a great opportunity for us and offers, a wealth of knowledge. Of course, within the Mediterranean, there are different countries, different cultures, different religions, different languages being spoken. And as we can bridge the gap between all of those and kind of work together on these common elements, it'll make the business even more successful. So a third of the export industry within the Mediterranean takes place within the Mediterranean itself. So Italy trading with France and Greece trading with Spain and that type of thing. And that's an important note too. And that's why on the panel we wanted to have people from different countries within the region be present so that we could talk about those type of things and kind of come up with some different types of solution. Imports and exports account for about 20 to 40% of the GDP in a lot of the Mediterranean countries. And I wanted to talk a little about the history of trade in the Mediterranean, because when we talk about trade and we talk about business, it seems like a very new thing. Even the Mediterranean lifestyle as a commodity, it wasn't just the Freudian slip that Andrew made. It's a very new kind of term that we're talking about, but it's actually very old. Just like culinary diplomacy, it's a new term for us, but it's also a very old thing. So this is some of the trading. So you can see the cultivation of peas, for example, started in 6500 before the Common Era in the Mediterranean. This was a very important trading vessel that allowed food. It was a very important commodity in ancient times. As we go to the period between 6000 and 3150 before the Common Era, we can see this colony is Bat Ur, which was mentioned later in the pre-dynastic period of Egypt. This is in the modern day Israel, which mentions a lot about trade and different things that were happening around the Mediterranean Sea. Then, if you fast forward a little bit to 2100 before the Common Era, we can talk about the early Bronze Age and also other settlements that were destroyed later on, but they have been known to be host to a lot of trade within the Mediterranean. As we go to 2000 before the Common Era and 1650, then we head to the island of Santorini. So these two places, Thera and Akrotiri, are very important settlements with areas of ruins in the island of Santorini. This was a very important trading center in ancient times. It's important to think about food not only as a commodity, but was also listed as culinary medicine in the ancient world. So here in Egypt, for example, we have evidence that Pythagoras, who we all know from the Pythagorean theorem and as being an important philosopher, he was also very interested in nutrition and science and music and philosophy. He actually studied in Egypt with some of the high priests. And we have examples of what their medical texts were, some of the things that they did in terms of diagnosing and treating ailments at a very early time. And what is really interesting to me is that in 1973 in England, they tested out a lot of what they were finding in the ancient Egyptian texts. And they found that 67% of the ancient Egyptian remedies to be true and compliant with modern British standards. So I always tell people, that doesn't mean that the other 33% aren't compliant. It just means that maybe we haven't quite gotten there yet. But 67% from ancient times to now is a pretty big number. And also trading was very important, of course, for the ancient Egyptians. Food was their number one commodity. The Nile used to flood twice a year. So as it flooded, it provided natural irrigation that would support all the plants and the crops that were its currency. And that's why the ancient Egyptian empire spread from modern-day Sudan all the way up into the Levant region. But salt was one of the first things that was exported out of Egypt at a very big commercial level. This was about 2800 before the Common Era. And the salt was exported to the Phoenicians. So the Phoenicians were really key in the trade in the Mediterranean. You know, nowadays we look at everything with nationalistic borders. We think about the French and the Italians and the Moroccans. But we don't really think about these big groups of people that brought them and brought everybody together. And the reason, for example, aioli is on a lot of menus in restaurants today is because of the Phoenicians. We actually found aioli sauce in little vessels in Phoenician trading ships that were recently uncovered from the sea. So they brought around, that's why some people say, oh, aioli is Spanish, oh, it's French, oh, it's Italian. Well, everyone had it, thanks to the Phoenicians. You know, so there are a lot of things like that. Salt was very important in terms of medicine, in terms of health, and in terms of commodity. You couldn't have a city if you didn't have access to health. And there was a lot of taxation on, if you didn't have access to salt. And there was a lot of taxation on the salt as well. So the Phoenicians were really in power from about 1200 before the Common Era to about 800. So in this 400-year span, they brought things back and forth all around the Mediterranean and kind of set up cultural areas of exchange and ideas and recipes, all of that at the same time. So Phoenician colonization set up a lot of largely trading posts that are found throughout the Mediterranean. And you can see them today everywhere from Byblos in Lebanon to the northern coast of Morocco, in Italy, in southern France, and all of these places. Then in about 1000 to 338 before the Common Era, we start to see the ancient Greek civilization in Greece really flourishing and taking over a little bit of the trade from the Phoenicians. The Greek colonization went throughout the Mediterranean and the Black Sea. Then between 800 and 600 before the Common Era, this is labeled as the second stage of trade between the Phoenicians. And many of the areas that they had trade with then became full colonies. So this is Pythagoras again. So Pythagoras, the reason I like to mention him a lot is because he set up a school in the town of southern Italy of Crotone, where my family's from. But he was exiled from Samos in Greece, and he came to Crotone and set up his school there and studied all of these things that he then let people study. Women were allowed to study as well, nutrition, philosophy, music, and mathematics, of course. And he was the father of vegetarianism in the West. So a lot of people believe that he really set the stage for what became known later as the Greek diet, which then became known as the Mediterranean diet. And of course, even within Greece, there are variances of different diets, but we believe that Pythagoras is kind of at the forefront and one of the forefathers of that as well. And then there are a lot of religious influences that we can see on trade in the Mediterranean. And you know, a lot of times when we look at religion and history, there's a lot of mention of war and what wasn't happening because of that, you know, that time period. But actually, there was a lot of trade that happened because of religion and a lot of ideas that were exchanged and a lot of, you know, religion spread and flourished through trade and vice versa. So it's a very interesting way of looking at things and also a way of looking at food as spirituality, of food as sacred. You know, we fast and we celebrate, we fast and feast both with food. And what are kind of the concepts around that? Those notions are still prevalent in the Mediterranean region today, whether people are, you know, full-blown practicing their religion or just do it to some kind of cultural level. But the notions behind food as being sacred, foods that we take for granted, like Chef Xavier's wonderful bread over there, that, you know, at one time could have been a communal offering or a mortuary offering to a god. So that notion of food as sacred is at the base of a lot of the Mediterranean lifestyle. So I'd like to talk about that, especially 539 BC, we see like the Etruscans and the people coming and expelling Greeks from Corsica, the island of Corsica. So that started a lot of different change on that island. In 323 before the Common Era to 31, we see the Hellenistic civilization in Greece start to flourish. Also in the Mediterranean, in Central Asia. So a huge influence from the Greeks going out into the world at that time. And then in 42 of the Common Era until 62, we see the works of St. Paul and the missions that were kind of set out through him. Also the idea of the worship of Isis, or as I say in English, Isis. But the goddess Isis from Egypt has such a huge claim throughout the Mediterranean region. Paris got its name from the Latin para Isis, or for Isis. In many of the cities, even in Italy, you will see temples under the churches who were to Minerva. Minerva was the Italian name given to the goddess Isis, because people in those times, they used to combine the gods. So what was Egyptian was Greek, what was Greek was Italian. They kind of shared them, but they gave them the same names. So we have a beautiful church in Rome called Santa Maria Sopra Minerva, which means Saint Mary on top of Minerva, or the goddess Isis. So you can go to these churches and see these ancient temples at the bottom. And just like their architectural structures were set up, so were the ideas, the foundations of the culture, the lifestyle, the food that spread everywhere. Because people, again, at that time weren't worried about nationality. They wanted everyone to take something and make it theirs, you know, call it their own. And then with the establishment of the various Christian communities, we see a lot in the Eastern Mediterranean that could be, you know, shared between Greece and Syria and Egypt and the countries that are practicing the Eastern Orthodox religions. And of course, because of Roman Catholicism in Rome and the more Western countries, we start to see a lot of similarities between those countries, a lot of religious traditions that are carrying on over into culture, into food, into trade. And Apicius Bravus, I'd like to bring up, because until very recently, we were talking about Apicius from Rome writing the first century in the Western world in the first century. But here we see the fourth century before the Common Era. There was actually a Greek cookbook, and the name of it translates into Fragments from the Life of Luxury. So the idea of food is luxury in the fourth century before the Common Era, also another type of mentality that goes forward all the way in today in the Mediterranean region. Because no matter where you are, you know, whether you're in Morocco or Egypt or Israel or Spain or Greece or the south of France, everybody really believes food not only is a basic right, but is one of the entry points to luxury and to pleasure and to health. And of course, we have the Silk Road, and you know, this is from 206 before the Common Era. So you can see here very early on the different red lines, which are the connectors to the Silk Road, and then the golden lines, which are actually the main roads of the Silk Road, but connecting everyone from Constantinople, and even I would dare say because of their relationship with Venice, from Venice all the way over into China. A lot of food was exchanged at that time, a lot of engagement in terms of religion, and obviously trade as well. Now, if we fast forward, these are the main medieval trade routes. So you can see here, we've got a lot more trade routes, but in some cases, they're still the same as the Silk Road going forward into the medieval times. But now they're going all the way up into what we now know as Britain and Northern and Central Europe as well. And food, as you can see, is very, very important in those routes. You can even see here, you know, salt, wine, wheat, all of these things, spices, our honey, things that we take for granted nowadays, but at the center of this trade, in addition with silk. So some of the caliphates that influenced trade the most, and I like to bring these up because people, again, we think about nations, but we don't think about different groups of people that were influencing the Mediterranean. But here we have the Umayyads. So the Umayyads were originally from Damascus, Syria, and they were in power from this, most of their power was between the 7th and 8th centuries of the Common Era. The Umayyads were the first Muslim caliphate to exist, and they really established cities. They were known to be wine-laden cities. For some of these Phoenician trading posts and more agricultural and rural communities, they were developing full-blown cities at that time. And then we have the Abbasids. I'm missing a D there before the second S. From the 7th to the 12th century before, the Common Era. They were originally from Baghdad in Iraq. But they took a lot of their inspiration from Persia, and then they gained power through a lot of the Mediterranean. So we can see, for example, even in Morocco, Iraqi cuisine, a lot of the similarities between Persian cuisine, thanks to the Abbasids, because this was the Age of Enlightenment at this time in the Middle East. Then we have the Spanish Alliance. Sometimes we hear the word Moors, but the Moors, it's not really a political correct term anymore, but the Spanish Alliance were in power from the 8th to 11th century. So they brought a lot of things all the way from the Middle East, across North Africa, and into the south of Spain. Then we have the Aghlabids, who were from Tunisia in the 9th and 10th centuries before the Common Era. Most people who have been to Tunisia haven't heard about the Aghlabids very much, but they're very important. Even most of the Sicilian culture is based on the Aghlabids, because they claimed Palermo for their capital 50 years before they claimed Cairo. So we had a lot of exchange between Sicily and the entire Mediterranean because of the Aghlabids. Next came the Fatimids, same thing. They also claimed Palermo as their capital, and then Cairo and other countries. But what the Fatimids were really cool about was they loved cross-cultural entertainment, cross-cultural celebrations. They didn't want just different religions kind of off on their own, doing their own thing. They would put lights on the street, no matter whose party it was, they would want everybody out celebrating, that kind of thing. And the Fatimids were known for reinstating the little desserts, like the sesame candies, the nougats, what we call the torrone, those kinds of things that were associated with pagan festivals many, many years before. A lot of religions outlawed them. They outlawed the festivals, they outlawed the food. And then the Fatimids came in and they were like, hey, this has nothing to do with this. It's nothing sacrilegious about sweet a candy. So they reinstated the candy, and that's why, like, whether you're in Spain or Italy or Egypt, you can eat these types of sweets. In Egypt, they'll have them for the Prophet Muhammad's birthday. In Sicily, they'll have them for the Feast of Santa Cecilia. But all of this idea came behind the Fatimids. And then they have the Ayyubids, who Saladin was part of this dynasty in the 12th to the 13th century. And again, they brought, as they established in different countries, they brought all of their ideas in exchange with them. The spice trade was very, very important. Spices were literally like gold. People could afford very little of them. That's why a lot of our European Christmas specialties have just a little bit of spice in them, a little bit of jemmy, or a little bit of car, because it was too expensive to use them on a daily basis. But of course, in India and in the Middle East, they were used in much larger amounts, and they were used as medicine as well. So we're kind of discovering that now. But the spice trade formed a circle between Venice and Constantinople, which is now Istanbul, over on the top right, and then Cairo down on the left. Those three cities were sister cities during the height of the spice trade. So each of those cities was literally built on spices, and some to different degrees. For example, the Venetians, when they learned about the Dutch trade routes that the Dutch would be taking over, they realized they weren't going to have access anymore, and they realized they were going to go bankrupt. So instead of spending all of their money or just worrying and kind of holding on to it, they decided to use the money that they had to purify the city and build the frescoes on the canal. So the Venice that we know was not only built on the spice trade, but built on the collaboration between Venice and the eastern parts of the countries as a result of this. A lot of trade going on at that time. At this time period, they would actually, a Persian carpet made in Turkey was worth more money than Michelangelo's David. So there was a very high, luxurious kind of connotation with anything coming from the Middle East. And they used to have counterfeiters that would write in what looked like Arabic script, but because people in Europe couldn't read it, they didn't know. So there was a big counterfeit market on that at the time. And then we can see here the Ottomans. So I think the Ottomans were the number one food marketers in the world. I mean, if you think about how many things we associate with Turkey in the world that was brought around by Turkey, but wasn't necessarily grown in Turkey, like, for example, Turkish coffee. Or, in Italy, we call corn grano turco, which means Turkish grain. And of course, we got it from the New World, but the Turks were in charge of bringing everything around. And so that knowledge of trade, that knowledge of marketing, things, we would eat very differently in America today if it weren't for the Ottomans. So this is kind of, this little map gives the reign of different sultans and tells kind of what they're doing, different things like that. And of course, Columbus, after the introductions via Spain, all of these products were brought back into Europe. So tomatoes, corn, a lot of different herbs, mushrooms, and the vanilla bean, chocolate. We wouldn't have these in Europe if it weren't for what happened after Columbus. So Columbus brought these back in. And now it's very hard if you go to try to tell someone in Southern Italy, for example, that the pepper isn't indigenous from there. It's very hard to convince them that it's not, or tomatoes. But before the 17th century, they were not known in Europe. So very important type of revenue back then, and very important source of revenue now. Nowadays, some of the biggest sources of revenue in the Mediterranean region that has to do with the United States and the world are tourism, definitely number one. And then the fisheries are number two, extra virgin olive oil, herbs, and then branding, what is called GIs, which means geographic indicators. So nowadays, if for a feta to be really a feta, it has to be a Greek feta, and it has to go through a certain certification process. Parmigiano Reggiano, DOP, and there's a DOP after it, has to go through various strategic measures in order to be able to be analyzed, and to be proven, and to get certification that has those things. And we also have GIs. We have wild game blueberries, we have Idaho potatoes, those kinds of things. GIs are a wonderful invention because they help countries, states, you know, local economies protect their product and really be able to gain more revenue of them. And so that's one of the ways that we're working very closely within the Mediterranean. But the first thing that I want to talk about is tourism, really, because it is the number one commodity in the Mediterranean right now. And I lead cuisine and culture tours to different places in the Mediterranean, to Morocco, to Greece, to Italy, to Turkey, and also in the past Egypt. And these are some of the things that we go over when we're there, and some of the reasons why these areas are becoming more popular. Obviously, you know, beautiful places are a hard sell. There are many places in the Mediterranean, right, we could just go tomorrow very happily on our own. But there's a new cultural component that we're trying to add in, and a wellness component that we're adding into these tours as well, so that to kind of promote the Mediterranean lifestyle in a larger, from a larger perspective. And 11% of the total region's GDP comes from tourism. This is according to the World Wildlife Federation. There's a need for long-term sustainable tourism. Because unfortunately what happens in a lot of countries, depending upon who's in charge and depending upon the local economy at the moment, sometimes people can be very short-sighted and want to get very large numbers of tourists in to make money, but then the water gets polluted or the air gets polluted or things like that. So in my personal experience, I've seen this in Egypt and in Greece. And in Egypt, for example, they'll get day tour people into Luxor to visit the Valley of the Kings from the Red Sea, who are mostly staying in the Red Sea, but they just want a quick trip. It costs so much transport to get those people over to the Red Sea in order for one day, you know, to visit these monuments. So prior to the revolution, they had started actually limiting the amount of people that were coming in to kind of preserve a little bit of the monuments. And the same thing in Santorini, they were getting about 5,000 people a day, and the Greek government just started limiting ships into Santorini for the same reason. So this was going to be a big talk that we're going to continue to see for the next decade until these kinds of things get leveled up. How do we promote tourism and promote industry, but at the same time preserve and protect what we have and do it in a more value-added way? So it's difficult to kind of narrate these trade statistics because you're going from country to country. Nobody's really doing it at a whole Mediterranean scale, so there's room for improvement in that area as well. And the second biggest industry right now are the fisheries. So they have an estimated collaborative value of $3 billion. And there's a big risk of overfishing. And of course there, because it's an important commodity, that has to be regulated as well. And people are starting to look at that a little bit differently now. Seafood is very, very important in the Mediterranean diet. So, and in the Mediterranean lifestyle, you know, historically, fish was always prized in the Mediterranean, no matter what country you were in. Fish was not a thing of, oh, we have to eat it on Friday because we can't have meat. It was, or I have to eat it because I'm on a diet. It was really a very prized thing. So all the way going back to the times of the ancient Egyptians, they used to have Nile festivals to honor the Nile because of the flooding and the great irrigation and things like that. So when they did that, they weren't allowed to take anything out of the Nile. What was there saying that they're only allowed to put prayers, flowers, things like that on the Nile. Then after the festivities, after the quote-unquote fasting, then they could eat fish again. So it was always like fish was synonymous to a very happy thing, a very good thing. And that sentiment translated over into things like the Feast of the Seven Fishes in Italy, where, you know, Christmas time, you're purposely eating many different types of seafood because, you know, literally like the fruits of the sea. It was a very good thing. And it's also very good for our health. So they've proven that just one additional serving of seafood per week can reduce your risk of heart disease by about 50%. So if someone's eating, you know, fish twice a week, it might be good to add it three times a week. If you're not eating it, add it in one time, that kind of thing. And the Mediterranean lifestyle recommends about 2 to 3 servings of at least fish and seafood per week. So a lot of, you know, great omega-3s and things like that. Then you add that in with the olive oil, which is also a wonderful anti-inflammatory, antiseptic, antimicrobial, but has also wonderful flavor and can enhance the benefits that, because of the good fats in it, can enhance the benefits of the fish and the greens and the other things. So very important industry in the Mediterranean, but also in the world. It's one of the fastest growing global industries. In the United States, it's the third largest consumer of extra virgin olive oil in the world. And there's a lot of controversy about olive oil, so we're going to talk a little bit about that today. And then I kind of took a look at some of the different countries in the Mediterranean, how they were doing with olive oil, because it's a great source of income for everybody. Tunisia's exports are up 150%. They also had a record number of awards this year at the World Olive Oil Competition. Morocco hopes to raise its production by 250,000 tons. Morocco has wonderful olive oil. That is always part of my tours. They use the Maslala variety. It's delicious, very high quality product. Also, Turkey's exports hit number one within the last 5 months of the season. So a lot of innovations coming out of Greece this year. Greece is really, I think, more than anybody, in terms of, despite numbers, they've done more in terms of technology and in terms of advancements. So they've got a new olive predictor, which has a little miniature olive mill, which will let the polyphenols be tested, and it will also give farmers an idea about their crop before the actual yield of their crop before it is time. So they can test very early on and tell what kind of harvest they're going to have, and also the polyphenol content of their olives. So the Greeks are trying to get olive oil sold in pharmacies in addition to in supermarkets. And that way they will actually put all of the health information on it, it will be certified, and it bears all of these powers. And it's a great new initiative. 54 of the Greek olive oils were awarded at the awards this year. 93 Spanish brands were among the world's best. And the Italians won the record with 152 awards. In the world, Spain, Italy, and Greece are still the top producers, but that doesn't mean that there aren't wonderful olive oils from the rest of the world. And we can see here, actually put the success rate of each country in the amount of different awards that they won. You can see the best, you can see the gold, the silver, and then the entries and success rates. So these were the ones that were entered in New York this year. And I wanted to tell you all a little bit about olive oil basics for people who don't know. Because after you learn all these things, it's like, great, people go to the supermarket, oh, this is from this country, this is from that country, and make our decisions that way. But just knowing what country it's from doesn't really mean anything. There are a lot of other quality indicators that are important with olive oil that we should look at. So the first thing you need to know about, what is extra virgin? So virginity tells us what is important about the olive oil. The lower the acidity rate in an extra virgin olive oil, the better quality. So to be extra virgin, it has to have 0.8% acidity or less. That's the kind of the worldwide standard right now on what extra virgin is. If you can get something with 0.4, 0.2, 0.1, that's amazing. It'll be better quality for you. Also, the smoke points are higher with the lower acidic olive oil. So raise your hand if you heard you can't find olive oil. It's not true. That's a misconception. And you still hear it everywhere. I hear it all the time on the radio, on the TV, every day, but it's not true. Everybody in Greece and Spain and Italy fries an extra virgin olive oil. The only time they don't is when they want to save money because it's a little bit cost prohibitive. So you can definitely find it. The other thing that's important about the quality of olive oil and the nutritional component is the age. So the younger the olive oil, the better. In Italian, we have a saying, olio nuovo vino vecchio, which means new oil, old wine. Just like you want to age your wine, you want to consume your olive oil within the most quick time possible. The ideal time is 3 months from pressing. If you can get the olive oil within the first 3 months, you've got all the antioxidants, all the polyphenols, all the flavor. After that, it starts to go down a little bit. It doesn't mean it's rancid, you can still cook with it, it's fine, but it's not going to give you the benefit that it does in the first 3 months. The next thing that you should know about are cultivars. So cultivars are the variety of olives. There are about 880 different olive varieties known in the world today. We probably, within our lives, usually have a handful because that's for the most the big ones. But there are 880. They all have different flavor profiles, they all look different, and they all taste different, and they all have different nutrients. So you can examine which cultivars in your olive oil if you want specific taste and flavor benefits. In the future of chefdom, we're going to have, chefs are going to start pairing each course with olive oil just the way they pair with wine. So nowadays, you know, if you go into the first course and the chef will come out and say, oh, I put this with a Pinot Grigio because of blah, blah, blah. Now they're going to say, and I put it with this olive oil because this, they're already doing it in Italy and in Spain, and they're going to start very soon doing it in the rest of the world. It's very fun. You can play with these flavor profiles. And I have a lot of information about this on my blog if anyone wants to know more about that. The other thing that's very important for the health are the antioxidants. So in olive oil, one of the healthy antioxidants that's most known are the polyphenols. So there can be about up to 900 polyphenols in a specific olive oil sample. The higher the polyphenols, the more of all of the great things that the olive oil is supposed to do for us can work. Because all of those claims about, you know, reducing the risk of cancer and helping the tumors and weight loss and inflammation and all those things, if it's not a high phenolic olive oil, it's not going to give you all those benefits. You need a lot of phenols Phenols are also found in red wine. That's the thing that they say make red wine good for us. But olive oil, we can get away with consuming a lot more. You need about 4 tablespoons a day of good quality, high phenolic olive oil in order to start seeing some of these benefits. So that's a little bit on the olive oil. And of course, we're talking about trade all the way through. But still today, 74.9% of our nation's trade comes from about the top 15 countries alone. So many of the Mediterranean countries are involved in that. And we can use the food as culinary diplomacy as a way to get better trade within the countries and better diplomacy as well. And I was at an event a few years ago at the State Department, and John Kerry spoke. And he mentioned how what he had used, and Andrew was there too, we had this conversation before, he mentioned how he used, they put wild Maine blueberries on a menu when he was overseas, and then they could track the next year how much more, there was a huge increase in sales to that country of wild Maine blueberries because of that. Same thing with you know, the Idaho potatoes and things like that. A lot of things that we take for granted have a very high value in different countries overseas. So this is something for us to really look at and to explore in means of culinary diplomacy. And I just wanted to point out, kind of in closing, that some of the common tenets that the Mediterranean countries have together that can be part of the diplomacy as well are eating together. You know, before we even talk about food in the Mediterranean region, we always say you should talk about who you're going to sit with before you decide, or who you're going to eat with before you decide what you're going to eat. And that was actually Epicurus, but it's still true today. Very, very important. Eating people, with people, communally, no matter who they are, has a very good effect psychologically. It sets us up to digest our food better, to eat less, and to absorb more nutrients out of the food. So it's a great thing to eat together. Being physically active. So you know, whether it's going to the gym or you know, walking to your car, in the Mediterranean region, everything is a little bit more challenging. Like, there really are very few close parking spots. You usually have quite a few more stairs to do than you do here. You people usually walk to the grocery store and have to do little things in the day. And that adds up. So the physical activity is very important. People view food as medicine, as pleasure, as an activity, as a gift, as a charity. It's all of those things. And it's nobody laughs at you if you talk about food in the morning and at night and all throughout the day. It's a normal thing that no matter what your profession is, that everybody does. There's a great, of course, prominence and importance placed on fresh local ingredients. Everything starts from there. Meal planning starts from vegetables. It doesn't start from the protein. So this is how some good things that kind of set you up for success. And also, the Mediterranean region, no matter which country you're in, they share a lot of ingredients like produce, extra virgin olive oil, seafood, grains, and dairy. We have wonderful models for diplomacy. Right now, a couple of festivals that come to mind are the Couscous Fest that they have in San Vito del Capo in Sicily every year. You know, couscous is a food that a lot of Mediterranean countries share, whether you're in Sicily, that was brought because of the Eglamites, or over in the Levant, or in Israel, people have couscous. So they bring everybody together, and they talk about these different recipes, but they preserve the food, they preserve the idea of making it together, and they preserve the different cultures. Same thing with the new international bread festival they're having in Tunisia. It has a lot of promise for not only bringing cooks and chefs together, but also people and preserving the art of artisan bread. Here we can see increased Mediterranean product sales. And this is from Old Ways, which is a great organization. They started about 25 years ago, and they were actually the ones who put together the Mediterranean diet pyramid that we use in the United States right now. And I'm a culinary advisor for their Mediterranean Food Alliance. These are some of the statistics that they have. Hummus sales have increased $5 million annually and in that 10-year period from 1998 to 2008. Now we've got another 10 years. I'm pretty sure it's, when they get the results in, it's going to have increased that much more. Olive oil imports rose more than 137% just in that particular decade. Same thing now. We see that trade's going forward. We see a lot of, you know, quote-unquote Mediterranean foods like the beans, like sun-dried tomatoes, olive oil, pita bread, all of these things enjoying much bigger place on the market today. And so that's the end of my part of the discussion for today. Later on, we'll have the panel, but next I'd like to welcome Dr. Sam Pappas to come and talk a little bit more about the wellness portion of today's topic. Thank you.
Thanks, Andy. That was great. I always learn something like how you speak. I'm excited to be here. Thank you, Andrew, for the wonderful introduction. You and Jose have a wonderful team. And it's my second time here, and I look forward to coming here more often. So my name is Dr. Sam Pappas. I'm an internist by training. I try to combine the best of traditional integrative medicine using high tech and high touch. Just a caveat before I start, when I get excited, sometimes my New Jersey accent comes out, so I apologize ahead of time. So it's an exciting time to be interested in health and wellness through a Mediterranean prism. From the top, we have scientists doing a lot of research about Mediterranean diet and its benefits on brain health and heart health. But also importantly, we have from the bottom, you know, patients, people using technology to look about food, about fitness, talking about fasting, using apps to get foods, reading about healthy fats and saying, I want to use an avocado with my Greek salad. So it's very, very exciting. I think Amy and I are very much interested in collaboration. And I think the Mediterranean diet and lifestyle pertains very well to that. How do I think about the Mediterranean diet and lifestyle? I think a really good archetype is Asclepius, the god of healing in Greece. Amy and I are big fans of history and culture and myth. And Asclepian temples were places where you went to heal. And actually, the ancient Greek doctors were all Asclepians, like Hippocrates. And you went to these places like this picture here, and the Asclepian temple was removed from society. And it was in a beautiful location, and you went there and had great food, and you had spas, and you had wonderful culture, and you fasted, and you had a wonderful environment. And my belief is that the Mediterranean countries are modern-day Asclepian temples. So important to understand that and to visit them as well. I think a more modern example of an archetype of Mediterranean lifestyle and health is the story of Dr. Esther Sternberg. I don't know if you guys have heard of her or not. She was a research rheumatologist at the NIH. And she was working on a book and ironically developed inflammatory arthritis. She had a rheumatologist, a joint doctor, who had joint pains herself. And she couldn't get this book written. So her neighbors, who were from Crete, the island of Greece, said, why don't you go to Crete to get your book written? And after a month, she came back and she was all healed. And she started talking about healing spaces and said, you know, I don't know if it was the food, if it was the people, if it was me being in the ocean every day, if it was walking and meditating at an old Byzantine church that was at the ruins of a Greek temple. But she said a lot of things here that helped me heal. And she started researching healing spaces and talked about if somebody, for example, was in a surgery postoperatively and then saw a tree outside, they would heal. So I think, you know, think about this concept that's more than just the food. I have here kind of my views on Mediterranean lifestyle, and we'll touch upon this, mostly nutrition, but also the lifestyle. But I think it's important to mention the role of sleep, relaxation, the role of stress and resiliency. This is a Greek term, eustress versus distress, and relationships and networks. Research is showing that, for example, if your colleague is obese, you're more likely to be obese than if your parents are obese. It's a field of epigenetics, where genes and environments collide, where you can actually turn on and off your genetics. So the exciting part is that we implement some of these things that we're going to talk about today. We can actually turn off our bad genes and turn on our good genes. So what about lifestyle? I think lifestyle gets pushed to the side, unfortunately, and the Mediterranean diet is so it's so wonderful and it's tasty and we love to focus about foods. But these cultures in the Mediterranean really had more than just the diet. And Amy touched upon this, and the quote by Epicurus also mentions that. But they were physically active, you know, 30 to 45 minutes a day from the ancient time. Who does that these days? Many periods of fasting. I laugh with my friends who are from Northern Europe background. You know, they don't have any fasts in their culture or their religion. And it's been said that the Mediterranean countries, both the Christian and the Muslim faiths, have a more ancient faith and tradition and incorporate a lot of fasting. There was an article that even within the Christian communities of the Mediterranean, that the Greeks and the Eastern Orthodox fasted more than the Catholics of the West, which is very, very interesting. So we can talk more about that, but the power of fasting, an optimistic view of life, family ties. There's very little isolation. and special time set aside to relax. There, my twin brother lives in Holland, and he laughs. He said, you know, the Dutch will make fun of the Mediterranean cultures because they do things very slowly, and the train doesn't run on time, but I think that's a good thing, and we tend to forget about that. So when I think about the Mediterranean diet, I try to use my Greek, and the word diet comes from the Greek word dieta, which means much more than food. It's a way of living. It incorporates who you eat with, what you eat, when you eat it. It takes into account things like fasting, denying gratification. So diet is an important concept. There's an interesting saying applied to the Greeks, which I think applies to the entire Mediterranean region, and that's it's been called the bride of the East and mistress of the West. So a heritage, a dynamic traditionalism in these cultures, in these countries, that take from one culture and then export to the other culture, as Amy said, with the trade and the spices. I thought that was a fascinating discussion. So we'll get into some of the details in the example of the Mediterranean diet, but it's really the history of Western civilization and a collaborative undertaking. The ancient Greeks learned much from Babylonians and the Egyptians and passed it on to the Romans and then West. So the power of food, how do I think of food? Food is medicine, is a famous quote by Hippocrates. We'll talk about Hippocrates, of course, and some other famous quotes he has. Food is energy, entertainment, but of course, joy and spirit, as well as information. So this slide talks about, on top, the decrease in heart disease with these food groups. And we'll talk about some of the research in the Mediterranean diet world, but it's very interesting that even these research projects and these studies, people weren't 100% compliant with the Mediterranean diet. It wasn't always easy to do, even in places like Spain and Italy, where a lot of this research comes. But even if you just make small changes, even if you just add nuts, you get a reduction in heart disease of 30%. If you add vegetables or fruit, omega-3 fats, monounsaturated fats, the olive oil. So just adding 4 tablespoons of olive oil, for example, to a diet that's just average will have health benefits. So food really is medicine. Food is calories and energy. These are things that we think about and have taught. Food is entertainment. Food is culture. I love this slide. These obviously are countries not just in the Mediterranean, but we have our share from Italy to France, Greece, Lebanon, and Spain. I have to mention Lebanon and the Phoenicians. I married to a wonderful Lebanese girl, and she always tells me that the Phoenicians spurred the Greeks onto greatness, so I have to mention that. Food is joy, spiritually the truth, the fast, the food as a gift. Is a powerful concept we've kind of lost in our society here. And food is information to me is really exciting. You know, that, as I mentioned, epigenetics. So the concept of turning on genes, using the broccoli as an example here, you can actually turn on your DNA, that our genetics are not static, they're actually flexible. Which is really exciting because, you know, the genes aren't our destiny. They could be our tendency. So we're more apt to go in that direction. For example, if you have diabetes in the family, you may be more apt to have diabetes. But if you take certain lifestyle precautions and changes, you can actually turn off those genes. And food can do that. And a lot of these foods in the Mediterranean diet are among the top of the nutrigenomic chain. I'm a physician, and I always ask people, you know, should you listen to me? I was brought up in the environment of take a pill to match the ill. And I learned early on that medicine was great for acute problems, a heart attack, an infection, a cancer, but not for chronic illnesses. And that the field I was working in was really a disease care model. And I learned a lot from patients. I think the paternalistic side of physicians were very slow to make that change. They're very comfortable in their silo. And it was patients who taught me that, listen, you know, I tried this, did you see this research, to listen to that person on TV, maybe you can look and see what Jack LaLanne is doing, or, you know, your grandmother in the village. Food subsidies are very important to know. We all know when you go to these places that healthy foods, the vegetables and fruits often are very expensive. So where is the subsidies coming from, and how can we make a change to subsidize healthier foods? There are better choices we have. This is an example of what to eat and what not to eat. But how do we think of traditional diets? Michael Pollan speaks about that very well. You may have heard of Michael Pollan. He's a food writer. There's a number of wonderful sayings. For example, you know, eat real food, not a lot, mostly from plants. Or you are what your eat eats. Or you should only eat what your grandmother would recognize, as an example. He's had some wonderful discussions, and this slide really talks about what are the architecture of traditional diets. Of course, not just in the Mediterranean culture, but we see a lot of that in the culture. Food from fertile soil. Organ meats over muscle meats. I find that fascinating. You know, we go back to Greece regularly, we always would have organ meats. I know, Angela, yourself, you probably know that from visiting the homeland. We would eat organ meats on festive occasions. You hardly ever see that here. Arguably, you know, cod liver oil and a healthy liver is a fantastic source of nutrients, and we just don't do that anymore. Animal fats versus vegetable oils. It's been said that all traditional cultures share one thing in common: they don't espouse vegetable oils. And we'll talk about some of the markers of health. These omega-6 inflammatory fats versus anti-inflammatory fats. But vegetable oils are prominent everywhere. There's a lot of discussions about the increase in heart disease in America over this 20th century. And I'm reminded by a story of the cardiologist who took care of President Eisenhower in the 50s and diagnosed him with heart disease. He asked his colleagues, this heart plaque and heart disease, do you think it's going to be a new phenomenon? And they said, no, it's very uncommon. It's President Eisenhower because he has stress. This cardiologist went to med school in 1912, and his cadavers that he did autopsies on did not have any heart disease. There was no stroke. There was no plaque on their autopsies. So really, it increased over the years. And there's a lot of focus on sugar, but not enough focus on vegetable oils and fake fats. And of course, things like stress and whatnot. Other things that you can take a look at, from bone broths to unrefined sweeteners. Sometimes we throw out, maybe with the bath water. I think honey in moderation has a lot of fantastic benefits as a sweetener. Unrefined salt. Again, salt gets a bad rap, but salt has many positive benefits. And then again, how they cook the foods, so the anti-nutrients and things like legumes and grains were better absorbed. Western Price Foundation is another organization that talks about traditional food and cultures. Western Price was actually a dentist who went to third world countries and saw the health and the oral health of these cultures, and then mimicked their traditional health and really brought light into traditional cultures. And he said they shared some things in common. They had a good amount of fat. There was no refined food. There was abundance of plant food. Nuts, grains, and seeds were always prepared similarly. There was some animal food. And we'll talk about some of the arguments in the Mediterranean diet world about plant-based versus animal-based. And then things like bone broths were made. This is a fantastic book given to me by my friend John Crosby, who's here. This writer talks about the role of wild plants versus modern varieties, and that over time, our ancestors really cultivated plants that were pleasurable to eat and took out a lot of these nutrients. And it was a fascinating intro for me, because I just presumed that the apple was healthy, and that if I just added an apple a day, it would be great, to the doctor might. But that actually, a lot of these modern plants were low in these phytonutrients. Again, coming from the Greek word for plant, Amy touched upon these bioprotective nutrients, and I'll discuss this in a little bit as well. But a lot of these modern plants don't have these nutrients. We tend to revere our forefathers, but they also look to sugar, starch, and fats. That's always been with us. Wild figs and dates were some of the first plants to be cultivated. Early farmers and their grains, barley and wheat in particular, and then oil-rich fatty foods, such as olives and avocados. The ancient versus the modern. Purslane is a fascinating wild green. A lot of research that places in Greece that had purslane had more health benefits, and we now know that purslane actually has omega-3 fats as a plant. So compare that to the modern spinach, or modern corn versus ancient corn, and the amount of sugar and protein in it. So mentioning the apple, as I said, I was fascinated to look at this study that said, what happened if we gave an apple a day to patients? And it was a very small trial. 46 overweight men with high cholesterol, especially triglycerides, and in my experience, triglycerides are worse than cholesterol as far as a health problem. And they gave them a golden delicious apple daily, and the group with the apple had worse numbers. You know, so again, lack of micronutrients in these foods. You know, if you have high triglycerides, we now know that you probably need to be on a controlled carbohydrate diet. You know, we'll talk about how that implies and impacts within the Mediterranean diet world. But these folks got worse, not better. This book and others have talked about eat me-first foods. There are some foods that have maintained some of their benefits over the years and have been harder to take away the micronutrients, as mentioned on the list here, that we all know very well. Well, is really the Mediterranean diet a misnomer? Having visited it regularly, having spoken to people like Amy who go there, all parts of the Mediterranean, both the north and the south, you know, there's not one diet that incorporates all this. The amounts of things like fats are different. The type of meat, some more than others. Things like yogurt, milk, and cheese. Is the sources from goat? Is it for sheep? Is it for cows? The amounts of vegetables and fruits. The initial research was done based on Greece and Crete in particular. So initially, they had more health benefits. As we'll see, Greece has caught up with the modern world and really has fallen behind. And places like Italy and Spain have more longevity than Greece does. The term was first coined to describe the diet of pre-1960 Greece. So again, really a traditional diet that unfortunately does not always exist now in modern Mediterranean cultures. A lot of plant foods, vegetables and fruits, but also nuts. I think for many years we've kind of looked at fat in a negative way, so the importance of nuts. Grains and sourdough. Sourdough is very interesting. I think it's underappreciated. A lot of patients who can't tolerate wheat, whether they have the illness of celiac disease or not, and sourdough has a different culture, a different starter. And studies in Italy have shown that even celiac patients, those who have a hard time with gluten and wheat, can tolerate sourdough bread. So a different culture, a different starter. Legumes and beans, probably the number one source of carbohydrates were beans, and a great source of protein. Of course, olives and olive oil. Cheese, which again is vilified in modern times, but a lot of cheese in these cultures. A lot of fish. Amy brought up the point out, which I think is excellent. One of the trials that we'll look at, having 4 servings a week was fantastic for health. Less meat, but they did have meat, and I think that's another argument that goes back and forth about the role of meat. These traditional cultures from the beginning of time until now would often sacrifice to their god or their gods a fatty meat and have that in celebration. And different kinds of fats, and some wine. The research began with this study called the 7-Country Study by Ansel Keys, a famous researcher in Minnesota. And he was the first one to say, you know, can we look at food and heart health and see if there's a correlation? So we started this research project in 1956 and followed patients for over 40 years at seven different countries. And these are the countries here, Italy, Greece, and parts of Yugoslavia were part of the Mediterranean. Some countries had more than one site. And this hypothesis about fat and cholesterol being bad for health was a wrong hypothesis. As I say, right results but wrong reasons. If you look at Finland and Crete, they both had the same amount of fat percentage-wise, but it was different fats. And in the modern times, in the food world, a lot of discussions about Ansel Keys, is he good, is he bad? I think his aim was true. My position is he should have followed his instincts and his intuition. He moved and spent the last 20 years of his life in southern Italy, in Naples, and lived to 100 years old. So I think he was focusing in a reductionist way on just these facts and not looking at the total, but turning west out. I'm sure that the sun, his neighbors, his exercise, other factors impacted on his health at 100 years old. It wasn't just this low-fat diet. It was a wonderful trial, and it gave us the term Mediterranean diet. Within this study, Crete came to the forefront. And even within Greece, there was two centers of study. One was Crete, and one was Corfu on the western part. And they had differences. So the thought was Crete took influence from the east, and Corfu actually had more influence in the west, you know, had much more connection to France and England. So you look at the history of Crete, the Minoan civilization, it's fascinating because the picture on the right, which are both very similar, one's taken from a palace in Crete and one's taken from Egypt. So it's very, very interesting, the collaboration of cultures, again, the bride of the East and mistress of the West. And studies have shown that the pre-1960s Crete diet was very similar to foods in the Minoan civilization, so things really didn't change over those thousands of years. There was a lot of fish and squid, a number of different cattle, wild game, wild grains, including our friend personally, this high omega-3s, beans, barley and wheat. Interestingly, you know, wheat is much more of a modern introduction into the grains of Greece and the Mediterranean. For many years, it was barley, grapes, olives. There's discussion about the geography, and I think Amy touched upon this, but especially in Greece, the harsh climate and harsh geography does not lend itself very well to cultivation of many different foods. And the triad of Mediterranean foods back in the day was the grape, the olive, and the grain. So really, when you think about the Mediterranean diet, is the diet of Crete. And what we see here is that it was locally grown, minimally processed, wild plants, you know, three parts vegetable protein and one part animal protein, a lot of vegetable proteins. High omega-3 fats that also came from things like nuts and walnuts, and that olive oil being the primary fat. And this is the results of that seven-country trial, and they said that Crete had benefits and reduction of heart disease even more than Corfu. Close to Japan, but even better than Japan, and much more than Northern Europe and America. And 50 years later, half of the Cretan men were still alive, or all the men from Finland had passed away. So when I think of a Mediterranean diet, I always think about the ingredients. I love the term bioprotective nutrients. There was research done by a physician, ironically a Greek woman, Dr. Simopoulos, who's here in Washington, D.C., who's a researcher, and she said, what's so great about the Mediterranean diet? And she went and looked and said, what are the nutrients in these foods? Can we tag them, can we label them? And she found that, for example, that the Cretan diet had a lot of omega-3s, very similar to the diet in Japan, for example, whereas the Japanese had it just from fish, but the Cretans also got it from the greens, personally. And you can actually measure a ratio, omega-6 to omega-3 ratio, and she really kind of put this ratio on the map. And she said if you go back to the paleo time period, the ratio was thought to be 1 to 1, but that in Greece before 1960 is 2 to 1, Japan 4 to 1, and then much higher in Northern Europe and America. We can actually measure these things. So I love to use technology, and companies that do blood work can measure your omega-3 and omega-6, and I would encourage you all to ask for those tests. It's covered by insurance companies. Any questions you can always email me. My information is in the bags there, my email. You actually can measure your omega-6 to omega-3. And I love this test because a lot of my, I specialize in starboard men, and a lot of guys say they eat well, and then I'll get this test and the ratios will be 15 to 1, 20 to 1. But you can actually look at that. You can also measure these other bioprotective nutrients. So other ones are these antioxidants or polyphenols, as Amy mentioned. Glutathione is probably the master antioxidant. And again, you can actually measure this in a blood test. It's a wonderful tool for me to allow patients who I'm trying to assess how healthy they are and whether they've taken steps, you know, to incorporate the Mediterranean diet. They have a very low glutathione, a very low omega-3, and I realized that they had a lot of work to do. What we now know is we can actually use nutrients in the form of a pharmaceutical. I love the term called nutraceuticals. You can actually use a supplement that has concentrated amounts of an ingredient and have benefits additive to our diet and our lifestyle. For example, in the bag of goodies, I have some oregano oil. And you know, you open up and it smells like oregano, but it's concentrated oregano oil and it acts like an antimicrobial, a natural antibiotic. So I thought that'd be really good for you all to have in case you got sick. Anyone can take that, you know, kids or adults. But the power of a nutrient in a supplement. So using technology to our benefit, not just the foods. The term blue zones is one that you may have heard of. Exciting work done by Dan Buettner and the National Geographic Society with some researchers. Actually, these researchers looked and said, where are there pockets of longevity? And took a blue pen and circled these areas, and it became a blue zone. There's five locations, two of which are in the Mediterranean. So you have Okinawa, Costa Rica, Loma Linda, California, Sardinia, and then Ikaria, Greece. So another island, interesting enough, Crete did not make the cut. So again, they believe it got into the modern times in a bad way. So Ikaria is a nice example for us because it's in the Mediterranean and very similar to these other cultures. One of my theories and challenges in discussing health and Mediterranean lifestyle is saying, how do we push back on modern society? These five cultures have really in many ways removed themselves from modern times. There's isolation. We think isolated cultures have transmitted their inheritance over time. In Ikaria, they're very much, of course, have this wonderful diet, but they're very resilient. They're not very much into things like money. They don't worry about time, which can be a problem if you're visiting it as a tourist. So how do we do all this? There's a famous story in the New York Times Magazine about a Greek who was diagnosed with cancer, went back to his homeland in Ikaria, lived another 20 years. He forgot to die, as they said. So he went back to his roots and transformed his health without the need of medicines. A little different Ikaria than Crete. There was more fish. That probably had more goat's milk. A lot of herbal teas. Amy does some great discussions about herbal teas, and I think those are very low-hanging fruit when it comes to implementing the Mediterranean diet, these powerful teas. One of my favorite teas is, sorry, people know, the mountain tea of Greece has the same amount of antioxidants as a green tea. So I'll have that with a little bit of honey in it, and I'll get a lot of these bioprotective nutrients, even on the fly, even if I'm busy at work and not always eating well. A lot of socializing and sharing meals, which is very, very important. And what I find probably most exciting, they had a lot of coffee, a lot of wine. So I think this really speaks to people because I think a lot of times we want to give up things, and both wine and coffee at times have been given a bad rap. The coffee is very interesting. There's research coming out of Ikaria that coffee has a lot of antioxidant benefits, and you know, great for the circulation. Especially if these coffees are black, these dark roasts, like Turkish coffee, which is really from Yemen, as Amy said, or Hawaiian coffee, so the darker the roast, often the more antioxidants. And then wine. You know, wine is interesting, and alcohol in general. On the one hand, it has great antioxidants. On the flip side, it depletes a lot of nutrients like B vitamins, and it also puts stress on the liver, so it may be good in moderation, but some patients may need more than others. The exciting research also pointed to less depression and less dementia as well coming from there. So there's a lot of research on the Mediterranean. I don't really bore you with all the details, but I wanted to point two trials that I thought were very fascinating out of Spain. And most of the research now is coming out of Spain and Italy. The PREDIMED trial was a very large trial with 7,000 patients in Spain, and it was a primary prevention. So these folks had a high risk for heart disease, but they didn't have heart disease. And they said, what can we do diet-wise? So they had one group just had a typical Western diet. And they broke the Mediterranean diet group into two groups. Mediterranean diet, where one added extra olive oil and one added extra nuts. The researchers wanted to say, is there a difference between the fats of the olive oil and the fats of the nuts? And after 5 years, both parts of the Mediterranean group had significant improvement in preventing heart disease and other cardiovascular problems. And what I found very interesting with this trial was they weren't very compliant with the Mediterranean diet. I mean, they tried the best they could, but just adding in olive oil or nuts had a powerful benefit. So a lot for us to learn from. One of the right talks about a low-carb Mediterranean diet. This one's called a Spanish ketogenic Mediterranean diet. And ketogenic diets are very big now. You may have heard about them. You know, high-fat diet, a low-carb, more fat than protein. And there's a lot of benefit to it. But what I found very interesting was this small group for 3 months had a low-carb Mediterranean diet. 30 grams of carbs a day, you know, very similar to the first 2 weeks of Atkins or South Beach diet. But they had unlimited calories, 2 cups of coffee a day. Their carbs came from red wine and vegetables. An unlimited amount of calories, a significant amount of fish, 4 times per week, which I think is a great point. But again, other sources of protein like egg and meats and chicken. And 14 kilos, and, you know, about 30 pounds in 3 months. There's another similar trial, a larger in Italy, looking at the same thing. So when I think about the Mediterranean diet and how to apply it, I first look at what a person's body habits is. There's some research that thin patients have a higher carb tolerance, and that a lot of these peasant farmers in the Mediterranean cultures were thin by nature, and perhaps could tolerate the beans and the grains. But those that had more muscle, more belly fat, probably benefit from a version such as this. You do a low carb Mediterranean diet. So you have the benefits of it, but pulling back on the carbs. So in this approach, you wouldn't have beans or grains for the first month or two, but you would have the wine and the coffee, so I think it's a nice trade-off. So kind of in summary of the diet, is it a diet or is it a pattern of eating? It's embraced in those who are around the olive grower region of the Mediterranean, but studies have shown that if you apply the Mediterranean diet to places like Northern Europe or America, you can get benefits. So it's not just in the Mediterranean culture. Plant foods, very high compliance, so that's very important. But the challenge is, especially in Greece, is that people have kind of left their ways, and Greece, and to some extent Italy and Spain, have caught up with the West, unfortunately. The cultures that have the highest longevity is Switzerland and Japan. So it's very, very interesting. You know, we've kind of lost our ways, unfortunately. A moderate amount of fish, eggs. There was some red meat, although not as much as fish. A lot of bioprotective nutrients, as I mentioned, and the context of the social environment as well. This is my favorite quote in Hippocrates, so I want to circle back and finish up with the Mediterranean lifestyle. And I'll just read it very quickly. You know, positive health requires a knowledge of man's primary constitution and of the powers of various foods. But eating alone is not enough for health. There must be exercise. The combination of these two makes regimen. When proper attention is given to the season of the year, the changes of the winds, the age of the individual, and the situation of his home, if there's any deficiency in food or exercise, the body will fall sick. So I think this is even a better quote than food is medicine, where it incorporates the Mediterranean lifestyle. One of my favorite books that I love to summarize for patients is the story of a Greek American who was a wonderful student and lost his way in the 90s in New York City and became addicted to drugs and was on his deathbed and vowed that if he got healthy, that he would, you know, focus on transpersonal psychology and looking for better ways to help people. And started researching ancient Greeks like Plato and Pythagoras. You know, as Anthony mentioned, Pythagoras is one of our favorites. And he looked at it and said, how did the Greeks look at health and what are some concepts that we could apply in our modern times. And I love these combinations. Rigorous physical exercise. Think of the ancient gymnasium that you were taught ethics as well as fitness. Strict diets, periods of fasting, daily meditational walks, lessons on ethics and character, and contemplation on higher causes. As he likes to say in the book, you know, these ancient Greeks would have a daily walk followed by contemplating the cosmos in front of a body of water or something of nature. When I think of this, I think about the tension in the nutrition world and the Mediterranean diet. You have these two camps, and it's analogous to modern society, but you have the one camp that says Mediterranean diet is very good, but emphasizes the plants. So everything is plant-based. A lot of times plant-based is a term for vegan. Nothing wrong with that, but they've kind of taken out of context some of the other benefits and said, we're just going to do plants. And in my experience, a lot of patients who have high triglycerides, want to lose some weight, can't lose weight on just a plant diet. And you have the community that says that fats are really good, so we're going to focus on the fats. That's got to be a ketogenic diet. And my concept and my thinking is we need to personalize. And I think history gives us a great lesson. Pythagoras is a great example. He was one of the first ascetics. He was a vegetarian. But his good friend was Milos, who was a neighbor and a famous wrestler in ancient Greece and won the most events in wrestling in the Olympics. And he advised him to have more meat, to have some more bread. He was very built. And he said, you need more meat and more wine. So I think it's a wonderful concept for us to look at and say, can we take what's useful and disregard the rest? And can we do a personalization of the Mediterranean diet and lifestyle? So I'll stop there. Another famous quote. So we'll stop there. I want to remind you all to please grab some bags if you haven't yet. We're going to take a few minute break, I believe, and then we'll circle back to the group here. Thank you very much.